everyone. My name is Miss Sabrae.
Hi, I'm Yada.
And this is the Sabrae Show Live, where we control our own narratives and have the conversations that we need to have in order to empower our community. Let me introduce our special guest.
This is Reese.
No world.
And this is my man Brian.
How you doing?
And we are here to bring the topic of discussion: can you be pro-black / conscious / combating white supremacy and racism while dating interracially? So, who would like to start?
Listen, I don't know.
Okay, let's just go around. I say no as well. Me, Yada, we both agree that no, you cannot be conscious / pro-black / combating white supremacy, racism while dating interracially.
Nope.
And what about you, Brian? Just simply yes or no?
I say no. I think that you can actually.
Yes,
you can be both.
Okay, and Reese?
I'm gonna say this. Yes, you can date interracially and you can be pro-black.
Okay. So let's get into it. The guys say yes, the girls say no. Why do you say no, Yada?
I say no because I feel like there's always going to be a conflict of interest, like realistically. Mm-hmm. And I think it stems first from how do you define pro-black? And mm-hmm. I define pro-black as you putting the good of your black race above the good of other races. And it's not to say that you're anti-white or you're anti-anything else. It just means, hey, I don't wish you bad, but I got to kind of worry about mine first.
Yeah.
So how does that manifest in your relationship when you're basically putting the betterment and the good of your race above other races and that person is outside mm-hmm. of your race? It's like I feel like at some point that's going to fall by the wayside and they're going to be on the opposite end of that at some point, or their race is, and they're gonna feel some type of way about it. So it's like, how do you maintain that balance if, you know, there's a conflict that arises between you two races? This is like, for example, you can take it back to like the O.J. Simpson trial, you know? Mm-hmm. And, you know, it was like black against white everywhere, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's like, all the black people were like, yeah, he got acquitted, and the white people were like, nah. So it's like, just imagine being in an interracial relationship at that time. It was probably a lot of conflict. Some people probably broke up behind something like that. Because it's like, how do you find a balance?
It's a big difference in cultures. And it's like, not that to say that you can be, you know, you can't be with someone of a different culture than you, but it's like, it's such a big deal. Like, you'll almost be double-minded, especially being pro-black. And to me means, you know, living a lifestyle that combats systematic racism, white supremacy.
Absolutely.
And like, how can you be loyal to your people when you're in love black people, but you're in love with white people?
Right. And just to be clear, we're specifically referencing dating white people, or is it just...
Interracial dating in the black community, 80% of the interracial couples are black and white. So,
gotcha.
We're speaking in general, but for the most part, it's black and white.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm.
First thing I want to say is, it's initially sad for me that the gentlemen and the women are separated on this topic.
And you know what, I did find that when I surveyed people throughout the week and asked me like my clients and stuff like that, it seemed to be like all of the women say yes. I mean, say no. All of the men say yes.
Honestly, I'm not surprised, to be honest.
Yeah. No, I'm not surprised myself because I think it stems into something bigger.
Mm-hmm.
Me saying, and I'm pretty sure, I can't speak for you, but I'm pretty sure you feel the same way. Me saying that, yes, I think they can coexist, doesn't mean that I'm taking anything away from my sisters.
Yeah.
Like, at the end of the day, I definitely think you can be an individual who uplifts his community. But a lot of like love and just finding the right person is access. If I'm from Colorado and you know I'm raised around all types of different nationalities and I don't have as much access to black women, I can find out about myself and want to empower women.
Mm-hmm.
But I may have just fell in love with an individual who builds me and makes me feel just as good.
Proximity is definitely a factor.
Absolutely.
Definitely. What about you, Reed?
So my thing is this in regards to it. Being pro-black, being pro-anything doesn't mean exclusivity to that certain category.
Mm-hmm.
If you're a feminist, for example,
mm-hmm.
you're very pro-woman.
Which we are not. Well, I'm not.
Okay.
Not today.
Not today.
But just to say that, going, that doesn't mean you only date women.
Mm-hmm.
Correct? Do you date women?
Well,
that doesn't... I think
because the feminist woman doesn't necessarily, you know, equate to your dating preferences. It's just more of that equality aspect, more of that empower, you know, women's empowerment. But it doesn't mean you're necessarily a lesbian.
Right.
I get what you mean.
Correct. So saying that, being pro-black doesn't mean that I only have to date a person of my color. It's not mean that. It means,
right, but you could kind of see the hypocrisy in that, though. That's kind of just like
a contradiction. Only because the pro-black lifestyle is, but the main thing that strengthens the black community is the black family.
Yeah, that's not basically like, diluting the black family. You know, it's not to say that biracial people don't necessarily, you know, aren't black, because, you know, of course, there's always the one drop rule, what have you. But it's really like, of course, we have to take into account that, you know, the purity of our blackness may be in question per se, because exactly. All we're doing, I just feel like in doing so and calling yourself pro-black, but then actively contributing to, you know, further diluting the race, it's kind of like,
But you're saying it as though, like, an individual, like, is just, they have beautiful black women that embody everything that they want in a woman, and they're pushing that to the side.
Well, sometimes
that ain't okay,
though.
Sometimes. But I just don't think with everything, I don't think you could put it in a full and holistic manner. Like, I just personally think that you can embody more than one thing. You know, like he was saying with the feminist example, like, we touched on that before. You don't have to be a feminist. But still, like, as a man, I can say I'm a feminist even though I'm a man. You know, because, like, I still feel like women should have those rights and things of that nature. Like, it doesn't have to be closed off. We don't have to close it off to, you just have, you know, black women and that's all you can date because you're pro-black.
And to my point again, as far as the lifestyle of being pro-black and promoting black family, it's like, how can you, as a part of the lifestyle is respecting and honoring and valuing black people and black women, of course. And building the black family. How can you build the black family with a non-black person?
Yeah.
I just don't see how that is. And then I believe, to go to my next point, that it kind of like neutralizes your ability to combat racism, white supremacy.
And be effective, honestly, because realistically, a lot of people aren't going to take that serious. Don't get me wrong, because I mean, yes, you love, you love, but it's just like, I think about me personally, like the way I am deep rooted in my, you know what I'm saying, in my blackness, so to speak,
right.
it's like I could have fell in love with a million white guys, but
yeah,
it just was something in me that just doesn't allow me to go that route.
Yeah, I mean, it's like to me, very simply, like, how can you fight against a system but then go sleep with its daughters or its sons?
And it just kind of perpetuates, honestly,
that is
when
true.
Well, when it
got the niggas ain't infiltrating, they get in there and get up in there,
right,
and see a white woman,
like,
you know what?
Dating.
All lives really do matter. They start talking
dating, like forming relationships, because I mean, I know guys who will try to smut white women out just because they feel like, oh yeah, them men did it to our women in slavery days. Yeah, that's what we do.
Yeah,
and that's kind of it. That's not right.
No,
but
it's not.
I mean, like building a family, having a real relationship, a meaningful relationship,
right.
Children, marriage, stuff like that. It's like, nah.
And let's be clear though, for the record, like, I don't just like despise or like hate people who date interracially. I really don't care. I'm in a relationship with a black man, so I really don't care. But if you're talking about, you know, being pro-black, then we do have to bring that up. Fellas?
I just think, you know, all the world's a stage, and like everybody plays their part and their role in a movement. And I feel like, you know, what we sometimes have a issue of is we separate people because they don't fit into the perfect ideals that we have behind something. Nobody's perfect. So, like I said, if through circumstance they find this person, if it's something that you believe in, that you can find somebody who fits a mold that's for you, if they find that person who fits that mold, how would that be fair to them to say, hey, I understand you found somebody that is separate from the things that fit your ideals of, you know, building a family unit,
mm-hmm.
but you just want to throw that all to the side. I've got to go against what I've found as what God has put in place for me. If you believe in that, I have to go against that because that would make me not pro-black.
No.
You can be more than one thing. You can embody that without having to be stuck in like in a box that people put you in. And I just feel like right now in society, it's like we have like purest of things. Like you have to be, in order to be pro-black, you have to fit into this box of like, you have to fit every single rule. It's like, no, you can be that, but an imperfect person. We're all human.
Nah, so a traitor is a traitor, bro. A traitor
is a traitor. Life is not fair. I feel like life's not fair. Yes. At the end of the day, it's like saying I'm against murder, but I support the death penalty. It's like, what? Like, it's this, that's what it is. Like, I feel like life ain't fair. Realistically, sometimes
you gotta stick to the code.
But I mean, that's the code. That's the.
But from that perspective, once again, going back to the fact, so what if I'm from Colorado and I don't meet my first black
woman? Proximity is an outlier. Proximity.
But that's more the exception than the rule.
Exactly. You know, that's what all your, like, okay, for example, my dude, he went to a white college. There was, and he dated a white girl. Unfortunately, that everybody got flaws. You feel me? That's his past. But let me see. Okay, so you go to a white school. Say you got 10 black girls. Only 4 of them are cute, probably. And then you got, okay, a lot of people picking at them. So proximity does, I do understand that. It's understandable. But so many people out here, the statistics don't lie. I know that all of those statistics aren't proximity, is what I'm saying. That's like an outlier.
I could definitely probably agree with that. Like, you know, I've seen some ignorant things that individuals who, you know, who date outside of their mm-hmm. race have said, you know, to belittle all of black women.
Sure.
But I just think that goes into that same box. You can't belittle like everybody into a box of why they, you know, chose to date outside of their race. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, you have to deal with everybody at face level. What is it that this person is saying as to why they went outside of their race?
But it's really more so not even why people date interracially. It's more geared towards the people that are calling themselves pro-black. And it's like,
right, not in general, it's the
pro-black. It's like, you know, all people, yeah. Like, you don't see the hypocrisy in what you do. That's kind of odd to me. Like, that strikes me as odd. It's just like, you're out here and you're saying that you're down for the cause, you're mm-hmm. down for the people, you're here for our betterment. And then that, how do you think that makes those black women or those mm-hmm. black men, you know, how do you think that makes them feel, or how do you think that comes across to your community when you do that, and this is the community that you are for?
Look at all the backlash that Jesse Williams is getting.
Right.
You absolutely. Know, if you don't know about Jesse Williams was the guy, the black man who had this phenomenal speech. He's an actor on the BET Awards, I think last year, and he was talking, he had that, you know, just because we magic don't mean we not real, or whatever. That was like the little last punchline or whatever. But it was a phenomenal speech talking about the injustice and white supremacy and things like that. And he was married to a black woman, and now they're in the process of getting a divorce. But it's rumored that he is now dating a white co-star of a movie that he's on right now. And he's getting a lot of backlash about it. Now, I don't think that what he's doing, if that's alleged anyway, that's not proven to be true.
Right.
But if it is true, I don't think it should take away from anything he has done in the past. For you know,
and it makes it funny in the light, though.
Right, mm-hmm. But now, if that is true, which is not proven to be true, it does make us give him the side eye. Like,
wait, what?
What you doing now, though?
So let me ask you this: would you prefer that he had cheated on his wife with a black woman? Then?
Well, we don't know what happened, but no, I would never
cheat on his wife.
I would prefer, but
that's what happened.
Of course not.
So I have a thing about that, and just my opinion on it. Mm-hmm. I feel like this: you can be pro-black. And if you choose a date outside your race, that's fine, that's great. That's why I'm not against it, I'm for it. But my thing is this, of course there's gonna be certain limitations, there's gonna be certain situational circumstances, mm-hmm. such as, I've dated outside my race, I have no problem with it.
Mm-hmm. And we ain't bashing you, brother.
So I might be a little bit.
I'm definitely not bashing you for dating outside of your race, that's your choice.
It was an experience, and I'll just say that. Okay. And I would say my experience was this, and I've dated 2 white women. My first white girlfriend, I learned that there was a separation. There was an issue. And what the issue was, there was a disconnect that she did not understand some of my concerns. I started at a PWI, University of Dayton in Ohio. When I say 6,000 students, maybe 200 black students mm-hmm. at most. Half of those students are from another country.
Right.
The other 100, break us up, 50 from inner cities or metropolitan diverse areas. The other 50 are probably the only black kid in their entire high school lifestyle. The one thing I realized between me and my first white girlfriend was she didn't understand some of my concerns, some of the reasons why I was upset, especially during the election after Obama won, mm-hmm. how individuals acted. She didn't get it. When it came time to protesting on campus, she didn't get it. I realized that disconnect was a problem. However, my second white girlfriend, she got it. She understood it. She respected it. She supported it. And if she didn't support it because she wanted to be liked by black people, because she had all of her white friends. She never tried to appropriate any type of culture. She never tried to use slang with me. She liked her music and I didn't get it, but she was a great individual. What I realized is this. One thing about dating an individual, it's all about them understanding. If you're going to be pro-black, if you're going to date outside your race, it's about if they understand, if they can grasp that. If they can, it's great. It's not a problem. Now, if you're pro-black, I'll say this, and you're dating somebody outside your race and they don't get it, and they have an issue or they make side comments, that's a problem. That's when I'm going to say, we will question
you. Mm-hmm. I'm saying, you mean get it or actually like getting it, understanding getting it is one thing, but
you're never going to have that experience.
But it's like
when I say getting it and supporting it. That's what I use that word, supporting it. As long as that's the case, that's fine. But if you're dealing with somebody who doesn't support it or has their opinion like, oh, well, everybody goes through this, no, wrong answer.
Right.
Cancel that. And I'm going to use an example. As you use, don't be a menace. Don't know if you guys have watched the new show on Netflix, Dear White People.
No.
Perfect example.
Did they take that off?
No, there's a movie.
Oh, okay.
First season.
Okay.
And it's phenomenal.
Okay, I'm going to check that out.
Finished watching it in a day.
Go check that out. We might talk about that, y'all.
Yeah, I'm going to have to check.
And I'm going to say one quick thing. The main character, Sam, she is the leader of a pro-black movement on this PWI campus, and she's dating a white male in the show. And it's
she's dealing with on the low too.
She on the low.
Yeah, that's the thing. I heard about that show, and see, that's what it is right there. That's what pinpoints it right there, and that circles that hypocrisy right there, because it's like, why you gotta keep it on the low? Because you know it's an issue.
Well, because you gonna
you judge know it.
You gonna be like,
but you know why? But you know why?
That's the thing. You don't have things that you don't feel like
wrong.
She wouldn't
feel like she had to hide it if she felt like she could be a leader of her people and speak to people and have people follow and respect her without that, like, oh, you can't lead us, you can't say things, you can't be in our
because they're expecting you to live that life. They
right.
Expect
you to talk it like you talk it. Exactly.
That's
you're
not
shit. Like you talk it, you're going to hide it. And I feel like you hide it because you feel like it's wrong. And
exactly.
That's why you're keeping it a secret on the low, because it's not even just the backlash that you'll get. Because I feel like if I feel like I'm right and I can stand behind what I do, you can bring whatever you want to bring at me. I'm going to take it on the chin because I feel like I know what I'm doing is right. But if I feel like it's wrong, I'm going to hide it. I'm going to be sneaky about it.
And if the people out there who are dating, if you do date outside of your race or whatever, I don't necessarily promote it. I also don't have anything like against
right,
you personally.
Life, you know?
But as far as, you know, being pro-black is your lifestyle, it does contradict. However, if you do have someone, you know, you should definitely look at them closely as far as seeing if they are about the cause. Are they using some of their resources to help you as far to combat white supremacy? If they're willing to give up some of their white privilege in order to help your community, because And then another thing, like, they just have to be, like, not just saying, yeah, I agree, with that is a very big injustice, and what you guys went through was terribly wrong. No, but what are you doing?
Right,
so,
because
if you're living that, right, because if you're living that lifestyle, they should be living that lifestyle, and if they're not willing to live that lifestyle, then you're in the wrong situation, and you might as well just go back to your own. We got all the flavors. We got chocolate, vanilla, caramel, whatever. We got them thin. We got them real light. You know what I'm saying? So
then coming our race too. Realistically, I mean, my best friend was ash
not
blonde.
That common, but
my best friend is black, ash blonde, blue eyes. Hey, look, it happens.
But, and then if it's a chance that you are doing it out of like self-hate, or you know, you just want to, you know, you don't love yourself as much, then you might want to reevaluate that as well, get some counseling or whatever, and find out what's what. Back to the situation at hand. Another point that I wanted to make was if you're dating interracially, at this point, if you're dating, you're getting ready for marriage, or maybe not right away, but you're dating with the intention of possibly one day marrying. Marriage is a financial institution, correct?
Absolutely.
So women tend to outlive men on average. So when you pass away, whatever, and you're dating, or even if it's the other way around, you know, and you're passing down generational wealth outside of your race. And most of the issues that we have in the black community is lack of finances and resources and institutions and things like that. So you're passing down your generational wealth outside of another race. Do you think that race is really going to spend your money or invest your money with your people or their people?
Right,
with
themselves, to be honest.
Right.
It's all about how you raise, though. You know, because I feel like the a part of this conversation that could be a little bit problematic is we have to go back to the fact that a lot of our people are mixed. Where does that come from? You know, a lot of our people are like mixed, whereas we don't have pure African blood. We don't have pure English.
Well, because of slavery, right, and all of that stuff. So what we are classified as is really what it is.
So, but we can't throw away that there are individuals that come from relationships that they shouldn't have come from. Like you said, that slave narrative, you know, the slave master, mm-hmm, being in there. But my whole thing is going back to throwing away people. There's legit some families that have come together because they fell in love. And it's like, you know, they are raised in a pro-black family. They pass that generational wealth down to, you know, their black sons and daughters, or their family knows about that. They're raised as though they know that they have a complexion that's black. You know, our country is browning. So I almost feel like to think that you can't be pro-black is to throw away, like, you know, half of our people, more than half of
our people. But what does throwing away have to do with being, like, with the topic? Like, I don't understand. Like, I'm not saying that we should throw certain people away. What do you mean?
Well, what I mean by that is, like, it's there. It's happening. Like, America, because we're such a melting pot, it's, mm-hmm, like, we can't go to, like, we're not in a separatist space where we're just not seeing all different types of mixtures of people every,
yeah,
day. Love is gonna happen. And it's like, you know, with that being said, it's like, you know, we can either try and act like, okay, we can, you know, stay this course of only going with, you know, full, you know, as black as we can find.
But why can't it be a priority for in the black community to keep our situations black? To keep our lineage black.
Seems to be one, because, of the white community,
look,
for the most part.
Black, white supremacy, the white, you know, the Anglo-Saxon whites, they're in like a state of emergency right now because globally they're a minority.
Right.
So they are definitely trying to keep their bloodline pure. We don't have to focus as hard, I guess, because, you know, 23 black chromosomes and 23 other race, our genes are dominant. So that's going to automatically make that person black, you know, or more black than whatever else they are, even if it's half and half. So we don't really have to worry about it too much. But why is it okay for them to have a priority? Oh, you know, if there's a right to put of their race and their family, because when they, if they bring a black person home, their family is gonna be like, hold up,
you're right.
We don't,
but
do
like
that.
You said they're trying, but they're unsuccessful at that too. You can see that this
but the
country
point
is brown.
That's a priority for them, but it's not okay for us to be a priority for us. This country is browning just because when you have a dominant and recessive gene, that's just what's gonna happen.
Right.
But the one of the major reasons of the problems that of why a pro-black person can't be, you know, shouldn't be in an interracial relationship is that we're not emotionally equipped for that. Historically, black people getting together with especially white people because they may have the power and the resources and stuff like
right.
that, we're not emotionally equipped. You'll get a black person that's pro-black, like I said, one day, and then the next day, you know, they sleep, they can get in the bed with a white person, get out the bed and be like, oh, you know what, all lives do matter. When that, a white supremacist can get in the bed with anybody, just like they did in the slave times,
yep.
And they can still
have
your family, and they'll still get up out that bed, and they'll, you know, beat your grandma, beat your brother, you know what I'm saying? So even to this day, it's a lot of white supremacists who have Negro fetishes who date black people, and then they'll get out the bed and still do what's best for a greater good of the system of white supremacy. But we aren't there to the point where we still have a lot of post-traumatic slavery disorder where that's just too, it makes us too double-minded, it makes us too neutral, it makes us too soft. You know what I mean?
No, I understand exactly what you mean.
Historically speaking, now, you may be some outliers. I'm not discrediting that. But historically speaking, you do see a lot of that going on, and that's not a coincidence, you know?
Yeah, no, I just, I mean, we can respectfully agree to disagree.
Oh, for sure. All day long.
I mean, but because, I mean, you make some great points, but to me, it's just unrealistic points because of where our society is heading and the fact that, you know, like you said, there's so many outliers to how you have to, you know, like, okay, if you were raised in a spot where you weren't raised with, like, African-American women, you know,
mm-hmm.
there's so many outliers to it where it's
just... not that many.
Well,
proximity and what else?
So you got proximity, let's see, and the biggest thing, you guys, you find that you, well, you said that you feel that you can fall in love with somebody. Like, you can,
you
like,
can choose who you fall in love with.
So, but that goes back to the point that, so if you truly, on every level, you found an individual who can relate to you, maybe not, they've never lived your experience, because truth be told, like me as a man, I can't say I've lived your experience. Mm-hmm. So that's a struggle in itself. So I can relate and I can, you know, I can equate as best as I can, mm-hmm. but there's gonna be an individual who has all of those perfect things, but you know, I think that might be white. So you're just gonna throw that
you
away.
You can choose who you fall in love with. Just like you choose who you date, you choose who you're around the most, unless you're in a town where there's no other black people. And you can choose. See, you do choose who you fall in love with.
I'm not being kind of mood, to be honest. I'm not even gonna hood.
I mean, that's just me, but
I mean, that depends on your resources too. A lot of these things are resource driven, you know.
Then like, it goes back to just proximity, which is like literally the only outlier that I can really think of, other than, I mean, you know, you choosing to love up on somebody non-black.
But see, to me, I guess it goes back to me feeling like it's so separatist to think that, like, yo, like, if you find this person who fits into this mold.
Well, we can be separatists.
But I feel like, why can't you keep that in your own race, though? Like, that's what I feel like I would do. I can only speak for myself personally, mm-hmm. but realistically, like, if I could meet a great white guy and be like, oh, you have all these qualities and stuff, but it's just some mechanism within myself that makes me mm-hmm. want to seek that within my own race. And that's just, I mean, I can't really even, like, fully explain or describe it, but that's just ingrained in me. I feel like that would be great. That could be great. But I just feel like you're never really going to be able to relate to me, no matter how great, you know, like, it's, even though, like, yeah, we might live different experiences, mm-hmm. but I just feel like, in general, there's just, like, this general underlying relatability amongst black folks.
Even people that have different religions. It's always the clash.
I feel like there's going to be something there that's going to be a disconnect for me. And just because of that, I would want to seek it in my own race, to be honest.
No, I feel it. And to be 1,000% honest with you, you know, I actually tried dating a white woman once. My experience was different from yours. My experience was I was the one who was insecure. Like, I found myself, we went out twice.
That was that guilty conscience.
Yeah, I mean, it definitely might have been
like,
that.
Damn it, you know, because
it's nothing but black women. I was raised by my mother, my grandmother. You know, I've always been around my aunts. So, you know, I went out with her a couple times, and all of the things that she said were, like you said, they were like, I'm conscious to, you know, the way that this world and this society is set up.
But what was she willing to do?
Wait for another. You don't know. I don't know either. And
a lot of them aren't inclined to do
that. But you don't know that. You don't know
because
her.
Because what do they have to gain? They have nothing to gain. They have everything to lose. They lose some. Right. We'll have a lot to gain, but they don't have anything to gain. So saying, that's not human nature.
No, but you're saying there's people out there that don't do things surely off the fact that, you know, they know things are wrong. And they want to change society.
Yeah.
But
you're out there.
Oh, Lord. It's all right. You're out there. Yeah. But they
are.
They are out there.
Right there. But go ahead,
I'm
sorry.
No, sorry. But my biggest insecurity was when we went out, I would look at black women, and you know, a lot of times, you know, I'm just a friendly person, so I give off a good vibe. Mm-hmm. And it went from like people smiling at me and stuff typically when I'm out on dates to like people looking at me like
side eyes.
Oh, absolutely, because how black women feel when they see that is it just feels like it perpetuates those stereotypes that white women are trophies. Mm-hmm. And what's sad is that you get a lot of these high status and high profile black men that go and they get these white women, and then they say things like, well, black women are difficult, black women are negative. And I'm like, what you're not going to do is equate these negative characteristics to our race as a whole. And instead of individual women, okay, those black women that you dated, her, Lisa, Carrie, Sherry, whoever, they were combative and argumentative. It's not in the black handbook, you know what I'm saying? There's nothing in my DNA code or my genealogy that says, hey, you gotta be ratchet, you gotta be ghetto, you gotta be argumentative
at all.
No. So it's like, for that, it's plenty of smart, educated black women out there who are family oriented and what have you. But it's just like me, I can't give up on black men. And that's how I look at it. I look at it like you giving up on black women. And it perpetuates that stereotype that we hate so much to see. Mm-hmm. It's just like, yeah, he got on, he's good, you know what I'm saying? And then you go and you get your little white trophy, and it's like, really?
Yeah, I agree.
I mean,
so that's where those side eyes come from.
I know where they come from.
You've been quiet.
I'm just taking it all in. I agree with my guy right here. when it comes to, and I'll say this, the first white girl I dated, when I went out with her, I realized there was a disconnect. Mm-hmm. We were dealing with each other. I realized I'm going to all the black parties. They know I'm talking to this white girl. They're looking at me funny. My thing was, I didn't care. I came from a metropolitan area. I'm from Prince George's County. I went to a majority white area. I didn't give a damn. I'll just be honest. Because I know I like black women. Yeah. But I saw a white girl that I liked, and I said to myself, she's a cool girl. I had a class with her, English class. She's great. Kicked it. Then I started to realize there were some things like separation. But the second white girl I dated, Danesca. Danesca was a great girl.
She wanted to her. That's a black name, what is it?
Danesca Marie. Danesca
that's a black name. Black name. She might have been mixed.
Yes, I did, actually. her father's Venezuelan, her mother is white.
Okay, so she's white.
So she's
a great individual. Danesca was at every NAACP meeting.
I know. Let's get to the point. You propping her up looks like I'm saying.
It showed me that with dating interracially, that there are individuals who understand.
Yeah.
That I couldn't care about what other people thought. I couldn't think about, okay, she'll never get it. She was one of the few that got it. Yes, there's a small margin of individuals. But coincidentally, I found one of these individuals in that small margin, and that was great for me. Her and I together? No. Not anymore. I haven't spoken to this girl.
If you don't mind.
Something I did. So another story. Mm-hmm. Coincidentally though, and Danesca never was not one of those girls who only dated black men. Danesca has dated white men. She's dated across the board. She was very
cultured. Right.
She's married to a black man now, actually. Mm-hmm. That's the funny thing. And I saw one day, hey, left it alone.
She wouldn't understand like sisterhood, don't you say?
Debatable. I met some sisters that I went to school with, and they didn't get it. They had certain demeanor, certain outlooks on things, and I was shocked by them.
You don't study the history, you don't realize like what it's really about when it comes to interracial dating and all the aspects of it. All you think about is they're picking them over us, and it's the percentage, and you can't get mad at them getting mad at it. Because if you look at the percentage of men out here who are not incarcerated, and then you look at the ones who are disproportionately, the ones who are successful usually gravitates to, or the white woman gravitates towards them. Because very rarely do you see a white woman, a wealthy white woman, dealing with a poor black man. It's always a well-to-do black man with, maybe not poor, but, less economically sustainable white woman. So that can't be a coincidence there. And then two, black people in general have been brought up in to look at themselves as less than whites. Because if you look at the CoverGirl commercials, the Barbie dolls, the TV shows, the black people are always inferior or in a fucked up position, and the white people are normally doctors and lawyers and have cars and have a house, both parents don't have to work.
Right, look at the EBT commercial, the white girl check her pregnancy test positive, she crying, she happy, the black girl check her test, she blown.
Exactly.
Like, really?
So we have all of these things that add to that, and then you see, your man with the other women, and you're like, damn, And then it's like we're competing because they date white black men at such a high rate. It's like we are literally competing with them to get our men. Because while black women, we do have our issues from post-traumatic slavery and all that stuff, but so do our men. But we don't date outside of our race nearly as much.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
It's like the pickings are already slim. And it's like now not only do you have to compete with the black women, but you got to compete with the white women, the foreign women. Because for some reason, there seems to be this wave of, you got to get you a foreign,
Right.
It's like, it's disturbing to me. But then you got Serena. Got her white man. She
now, I don't
all you hear is
slack.
Black men saying, how do we lose one? How do we lose
now,
this
I,
one?
I don't cut
really?
No slack.
Oh,
but,
not at all. But it's just funny when you see it from that opposite stance. It's like you're getting this small dose of what we constantly see
but she does much. She gets the benefit of the doubt, though, a little bit.
Yeah, but it's like, black men, somebody said, oh, well, y'all called her a man for one. Y'all said she liked a man, so.
So I gotta ask, why does she get the benefit of it?
Well, because she's been publicly outdating Drake, Common, other black dudes that I can't think of right now. She's always been in and out of relationships publicly with black men, being publicly seen dating black men. None of them wiped her up. But then
within a minute, she slides to the other side. Everyone is devastated, though.
I'm not excusing it, though. Don't get me wrong. She just gets a small benefit of doubt. It's not like she she's a Zoe Saldana or somebody who only dates white.
But you can't say like, none of them like wiped her up. It didn't work. Like, for example, Common has a song called Love and I've Lost, where he's basically throughout that whole song saying he messed up and he's sad that he lost Serena. Like,
okay, so, but he funny how
I don't know if he messed up in the fact like,
but the devastation is hilarious. I'm sorry, the devastation is hilarious. It's like everybody wants, all these black men want to be so heartbroken, and it's like, this is what we deal with,
or they objectify her. Way as a badass, but go ahead.
Right, it's like we deal with this way more than y'all do, to be honest. But it's like when y'all see that one black woman with that white man, y'all are so heartbroken and devastated. Don't let her have anything going for herself either.
Let's be clear. I don't cut them a break. For Serena, I've just publicly seen her with so many black guys. I didn't associate her with the Negro bedwinch status, which is a female version of a coon is the Negro bedwinch. Let's be clear. I don't cut them any Negro bedwinch. It goes back to slavery. You know, the one who was like, oh, you know, the white, you know, slave master has all the resources and stuff, and I'm gonna, you know, be in the house. So all you niggas is just, you know, out right here. Hmm. You know, and it's a lot of black women, not as black men, but it's a lot of black women out here who had that same mentality, just, you know, modernized. Right. You know, like, okay, oh, you niggas y'all ain't good for nothing but dick and swag. So I'ma get Bill, who has the resources. I don't have to work. I can go
on Twitter when
Shea Butter Twitter. Jack Keys to get you adjusted.
Shea Butter Twitter is a detriment to black society. I'm hard on everybody when it comes to something wrong, as well as myself, and so on and so forth. So don't think that I'm on here bashing black men, because everybody gets the work who deserves it. Even if we do, you know, we'll get the work. We've had shows. Go check out the archives. We've got on the black independent woman thing. We've gotten on that. Check out the episode. But yeah, any last thoughts? Any last words? So I still agree that, I still believe that to be pro-black, you have to be committed to black people. So you can't say you love black people, but be in love with white people. You feel me? Or others. You can love who you love. I don't condemn you. But if you really about that lifestyle and that life, you gotta live it.
Walk it like you talk it. That's what I say.
I say this, you can be pro-black and you can date interracially, but if you're going to date interracially, you need to make sure that individual is committed to the causes of somebody who's pro-black, somebody who supports the causes within the...
And not just lip service.
Exactly.
There you go. I agree 1,000%. You know, bring responsibility to the table. If you call yourself pro-black, that means your love and your unit should bring something to that table.
You have the same values and morals.
And if you do, and you're a supporter of the show, and you dating a white person, let them give some of them resources so we can expand and do what we need to do. If you want to really, you know, say and speak power to your interracial relationship, allow them to give some of their privilege and resources to something that supports your culture and the well-being of your people.
Exactly.
That's all I have to say. So thank you so much for watching, y'all, and we'll see you next week.